Late night. I know I always say that, and it's probably getting old to you guys. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you for joining me. It is David from the 5x5, and this is the 5x5 late night show. It seems like I haven't done one in a while. I think a couple days I was just too tired. This has been a really, really, really long week with the weather, and I'm over it. I'm over the weather. I'm over winter. It's a shame. Today was like 30. And it's a shame when 30 actually felt warm to me. Like the few times that I went outside today, I went out without a coat. Because unlike last week when it was snowing and ice and all that craziness, it was very, very cold, like in the teens and sometimes lower than that, in the single digits. It was cold, but like today when I was outside, I'm like, oh, it's not too bad. So the times that I went outside today, I just had my hat and my scarf on, and I didn't wear my coat. But anyhow, like I said, it's been a long week. I haven't I put an older episode that I don't think you guys have heard on Spreaker. I did a 75th anniversary show in commemoration for Superman's birthday. I did that. That was back, I don't know, had to be in May. Had to be in early May because I was talking about Free Comic Book Day with Nikki and I. So you can check that out here or on iHeartRadio. Also, I hope I'm not yelling because sometimes it feels like when I listen to the playback, I feel like I'm screaming into the microphone. So I'm trying to lower my voice and not get so hyped. I hope you guys are doing good. Like I said, it's been an interesting week. I didn't get a lot of rest because my sister's car was messed up for a few days. Happened to be on the days I was off, happened to be on the days with all the ice and snow and crazy weather we were having. And so I had to take my nephew. I think Tuesday he was with me. Because they were out of school Tuesday, but on Wednesday and Thursday we're on a 2-hour delay. So Wednesday I had to take him to school, take my mom to dialysis, come home for an hour or so, pick him up from school, and then pick my mom up. Well, I didn't have to pick her up that day. And then Thursday was the same thing. I had to take him to school and pick him up. So I was like, can I have a day off? I need a vacation. I am planning. And I don't want to travel when it's cold, but I should. Hopefully next month I'll get to go home, which I call Atlanta home. I'll get to go home to Atlanta and visit all my AT aliens in Atlanta for a week or so. I might not come back. I'm done. I'm done with the Midwest. I'm done, especially with things going on with HRJ6. You know, there is a sect of the government here in Indiana that's trying to amend the Constitution to establish a definition of marriage between a man and a woman. Unlike most other states and all the states that have allowed same-sex marriages, the state of Indiana is trying to circumvent the Constitution and amend it to where once that's in the Constitution, it's in the Senate right now, then there's no chance for same-sex couples to be married in the state of Indiana or even recognized legally. So I'm assuming if this if it goes to November and it's a vote, Indiana is a very conservative state. I see it not I see it happening, and then there's going to be a mass exodus of gay, queer, lesbian, bisexual, whatever, leaving the state. You know, because why stay? There's you can't build a life here. Like when we're watching the world or even the United States see everybody being able to be married, same sex or not. I was never a I was neither for or against. It wasn't just for me. It wasn't for me, I guess I should say. And but the more that I like, I have friends that have gotten married, and but if that's my right, it should be my right, and nobody should be able to say you can't do it just because we say so. But I'm not going to get on that soapbox. That'll be a show for a different night. But thank you guys. We are almost up. Thank you for 6,000 listens. I know it's not a lot compared to some of the other shows here on Spreaker, but to me, this is the show that I started, you know, back on Blog Talk Radio, and then Nikki and I started doing more shows together, and then I start migrating to Spreaker more, and it's it for me, it was opportunity to say, okay, this is something I can do, something I like, I enjoy doing because I talk too damn much probably. And it's like, okay, and then it just start growing, and then we're up to 600, almost 600, 600 followers, which, you know, I'm don't know why, but I'm you know, I'm proud of that fact. It's nothing major, just that I'm still do this for fun. This is still amateur hour at the Apollo. And I enjoy it because if one person's listening or 10 people's listening or 100 people's listening, I thank you because it's fun for me to kind of hang out because, you know, I stay up all night and other than watching TV, although I will say here lately, I was not going to get into Doctor Who. My niece has tried to Doctor Who me for at least a year, and I tried to watch at the beginning, and this to me, it just seems silly. So the other day when my nephew was over, he was like, "I want to watch Doctor Who," because she's finally pulled him across the Doctor Who threshold, and so now he is watching Doctor Who, and I think he's finished. I think there is season 6 is on Netflix, although my Netflix wasn't working for some reason last night. Season 6 on Netflix. So I said, okay, I want to see what the hoopla is about. We're hanging out, my nephew and I. I'm like, we're gonna watch it. We're gonna sit here and watch. I want to see what you're talking about because he's going on, going on, going on. He can't wait to see season 7. I'm like, come on now. I'm a fanboy. You guys all know I'm a fanboy. You know, I talked about black superheroes the other day. I have a fanboy show. I collect comic books. I'm like, because I see other fanboys that are so into Doctor Who, and there's all this memorabilia out there. There's the little, and thing is, the stuff is not cheap. The little, what's it called? The little pin or screwdriver. The screwdriver that he uses, if you get a replica of it, like anywhere, like in a store, it's like $50. You can't get, just like Dr. Dre will never get $150 for me for some Beats headphones. He will never, well, whoever manufactures the Doctor Who merchandise, you will never get $50 for me for a replica of something I think is silly. This is a waste of money, but it doesn't mean it's not cool. And so, we started on season, I want to say 5 or 6. I think it's 7. I think it's on season 8. I don't know. I was like, let's start toward the end because he's, oh, watch this one. I'm like, okay, I'm gonna start right here. Then I'm gonna just start watching it. When I tell you I got hooked on this mess, And I will talk about it more on Sunday night for our Fanboy Weekly Show, 1 o'clock a.m., which is really Monday morning. When I tell you I got hooked on this mess, and I'm asking him these questions, and he gets hyped about it, and he's like, "Oh, and you need to know what this is," and I'm not going to tell you what this is. So I'm texting my niece at the same time. I'm like, "Girl, you need to tell me what this is going on and why this is happening and who's this, and I thought he was dead and who's the girl." And she's like, "Spoilers, there's a character called River Song in Doctor Who that always, because they do a lot of time travel, and anytime you ask her something that affects time, she was like, nuh-uh, spoilers." And it's kind of cute. But she's been on different stuff. I don't know what she's been on, but she's been on a lot of stuff. I want to say she's the same chick that was in she played a nurse on Nip Tuck. I think that's her. I could be wrong. But anyhow, so that's what how I've been spending most of my nights. But then I've found that the whole series run of Absolutely Fabulous is on Hulu Plus. I'm like, nobody told me. So I've been watching that as well, and I forget how funny it is. I want to try to contact one of the people, because it's supposed to be coming back. They've done some new stuff. They did some stuff last year. Of course, it's not the same, but I would like to talk to either Safi or Joanna Lumley. I would love to talk to her, or the chick that started Sanders, Jennifer Sanders. I would like to talk to her as well. But anyhow, I'm kind of rambling. Thank you guys for listening. It's the 5x5 Late Night Show. Please, 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 please check us out on Twitter at the 5x5, and the fives are numeric, or check out the blog where you can find all my written ramblings along with episodes. If you don't happen to catch them here on Spreaker, you can always catch them on the website at, keep on saying at, the 5x5.blogspot.com, and the fives are numeric there as well. Or hit me up on Facebook, facebook.com/ the 5x5 completely written out, and on Tumblr, the 5x5 completely written out. And although you probably have heard some the drive episodes here on Spreaker, there's a few there. I do most of those on Mixlr, another little live broadcasting site that's not as fancy as Spreaker, but I like it. I'm getting used to it. I'm still kind of working out the kinks on that, but I've been doing playing and talking on Mixlr.com, and look for the 5x5, where the fives are numeric, on Mixlr if you want to hear the drive episodes. They're normally at 1 o'clock Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, because I record those while I'm in the car, kind of off the cuff and not so structured. But thank you guys for listening. We're gonna take a quick break, and we'll come back and we'll get in to I Didn't Want to Hear That. We'll be right back.
Imagine a world where bullying isn't considered a normal part of childhood.
A world where I'm not afraid to go to school.
To speak out.
To be myself.
Loser. A world where I'm not afraid to be caught alone.
Come on, punk.
We have the power to stop the bullying. Speak out.
Speak up.
Educate.
Find out what to look for and how you can make a difference at bullying.org.
Bullying is not kids being kids.
It's not about good homes or bad homes.
It's not a normal part of growing up. I shouldn't be afraid to get on the school bus.
To turn on my computer.
Message. A walk to my locker. Did you know that a bully will stop his or her behavior in 10 seconds when their peers speak up?
Use your voice.
Hey, leave him alone.
We have the power to stop bullying.
Find out more at bullying.org.
Bullying.org.
Where you're not alone.
Where you're not alone.
Where you're not alone.
I'll be
That was Ain't Ready by Tinashe. I like her. I wish I could find her. I want to talk to her. I like the music. Anyhow, welcome back. It's the 5x5 Late Night Show, and I'm your host, David. And just sitting and rambling and talking and doing what I do best, running my big mouth. I was there like, because I had planned to be on tonight, and I was like, what in the hell am I going to talk about? Other than my other ramblings and stuff that I do and taking little quizzes and stuff. I'm like, eh, I don't want to do that so much. But I was like, what am I talking about? And so when I was leaving work, well, when my relief staff came in to relieve me so I could leave, there was a we had a little about 5 minutes to talk, and I didn't know in 5 minutes I could be utterly disgusted. And the first thing going through my head is, I don't want to hear that. And so what had happened was, that's so funny, what had happened was that's hilarious to me. Before he came in, I was watching a show on the television called it's the ER show, Secrets of the ER or something of the ER, where they have reenactments of situations that happened in the ER. And it's funny, it's entertaining. And I know they're reenactments, but I think the doctors and the nurses and stuff, I don't know if they're actors. I think they could be actors, but I think I want to say that they're real, but I'm not sure, so I'm not going to lie. But this show was also, it was a spin-off show, or a special edition of the show was Sex Sent Me to the ER. And you have to see that, but I think it's on A&E, I think. I don't know, or True TV, one of those stations. I don't know what station it is, but anyhow, and so they have all these reenactments of funny things that have happened in the ER. Sometimes they're serious, sometimes they're funny. Well, tonight, there was two stories. The two stories I was watching was one, a guy, an Asian fellow, he had him and his girlfriend was having, freaky sex, and so when they were having sex, I guess she wanted to be. She wouldn't have sex with him while he stuck his private areas through a where the knob was missing in a stove. You know how the old stoves had the little knobs, and he put his thing through the knob. It gets swollen and he can't get it out. So that was one. And then the second one, it was a guy who got a vibrator stuck in his bum. And I'm like, oh, these people are crazy. And things, I've heard this stuff before. It's not that much new. Not with the having sex with the stove. That's a new one for me. But same things, guys who use those. I'm trying to be tactful. Those rings that keeps your penis hard, and this it's called priapism, where the blood can't get back out. And so you had to go to the doctor and get it drained, all that kind of stuff. But so the same thing happened to this guy. And but they use this huge needle to take the blood out. I'm like, oh my God, that's so gross. Nobody's putting a needle near my penis ever. I it just has to stay. No, y'all can't do that. But and then I've heard stories about people putting stuff inside them that not that it doesn't belong. Well. I guess it doesn't belong really. And then get stuck or gets lost or whatever. So this is what happened to the other guy. And so, and he came in by himself, so he must have been using it by himself. But whatever. And so watching that, so my relief staff comes in and he says, oh, what happened to the guy with his penis stuck in the stove? I'm like, and that part came on. And so he was like, he says, and he says to me, he says, I don't use those fake things. I use popsicles. And so it caught me off guard. I said, excuse me? He says, I use popsicles. I'm like, what are you talking about? He's like, on the girls. I'm like, oh, okay. Because and I say this, and a lot of people won't understand why. My sexuality at work is a moot point. It's not that I'm not proud to be who I am, but in the type of job that I work and the type of clients that I serve, they could use that against me, and so and make up stories, and it can be really, really crazy, and I'm not trying to go through all that, and so and see, and since the staff gossips with the clients, I normally don't share that part. of myself with them either. Now, I'm sure there's one or two that knows, but not that it matters to me one way or the other. But don't discuss my personal business and work at work. I've always been that way. I think it's a time and place for everything, and not that I'm ashamed by any means, because I'm not. I think you have to be smart and when you're divulging that kind of information, because subsequently there's no laws to protect homosexuals in the state of Indiana. They can fire you for being gay here in Indiana, and it's all legal. They would use something else because it's not PC, but that would be the reason. And you would be fired and wouldn't have a job, and there's nothing you'd be able to do about it. Anyhow, and so he made the popsicle comment, and I'm like, and so he explained what he's saying. He's like, yeah. And so, mind you, this man is 68 years old. And I'm like, what? And so I said, and so here I'm thinking, I'm gonna put the period at the end of this conversation, and maybe it wasn't a period, I guess it was a comma, because I was like, man, I bet you was something else back in the day. And I guess he took a little bit of offense to it, because, and I kind of laughed, and I'm gathering my stuff, and I'm ready to walk out the door. And so he's like, back in the day, what are you talking about back in the day? He's like, I still am. I'm like, but you're 68, your back is halfway is out all the time. This is the same guy went and saved from his cutting his ear a few weeks ago, that he was bleeding, and I had to leave my comfortable warm house and go back down there and save him. And so I'm like, really? And so he wanted to give me details of his private life, and I didn't want to hear that. He starts off again with the popsicles. He's like, yeah, you get them to melt in there and it gets all sticky and it's sweet. I'm like, oh, really? I said, well, I kind of heard that before. I never said that I participated in this stuff. I said, well, I heard it before. I said, I watched The Real Housewives of Atlanta, and I heard something about confectioner sugar. And I'm putting my coat on, putting my scarf on. I have my bag, and I'm like, I got to get out of here. This man is ready to really give me the tea. And so he says, he said, oh, you didn't know I had three girlfriends? I'm like, really? He's like, yeah, I have three girlfriends. I'm like, oh, okay. That's real cute. And he's like, yeah, and we all mess around together all the time. We're friends. I'm like, oh. He's like, yeah, we're not exclusive or anything. We're just friends. And and on my days off, that's all I do. I can go five times in one day. I'm like, really? He says, yeah, on my days off, when I leave out of here Monday morning, that's where I go, right? Because I guess he has a girlfriend or his girlfriends in Illinois. He says, I like the young girls. I got a 38, a 42, a 41, and a no, a 42 and a 51. And and two of my friends. I'm like, what? See, and that reminded me something back in the day. Oh, one second. Hey, Grandpa Al, where have you been, Grandpa Al Kriska? Grandpa Al has joined us in the chat room. I haven't seen you in a very long time. It's good to see you. I'm glad you made it. I was wondering where you had been because I hadn't seen you on. The newest version of Spring. Oh, and then my friend Jeremy, he couldn't download the new version of Spreaker. Boo. Oh, computer troubles. Oh, I'm sorry. It's great to see you. I took a break for about 2 weeks, but I'm back in full effect now. I was letting some of that crazy drama that was in my face. I had to get that negativity out of my life. So I'm back in full effect and moving forward in a more positive direction, without throwing shade. You hear me? Anyhow, and so he's saying to me, they has three girlfriends. He's like, yeah, I like the young girls. Mind you, he's 68, but it reminded me of a time that he was late for work, and so I had to call him. I'm like, and so when I called him, a young lady answered the phone, and I couldn't tell how old I can tell who she was, but it was a young lady. And I said, yeah, is such and such there? I need, he's late for work. I need him to get here. She's like, oh, he's upstairs. I'm like, well, can you call for him? She's like, oh, no, I can't do that. I'm like, well, you're in the same house. Like, can you? Because I called his cell phone, didn't answer. I called his home phone. I was like, well, that doesn't make sense to me. If you're in the same house and he's upstairs and you know where, why won't you go tell him, hey, you're late for work. Your coworker is on the phone right now. And I said, well, just go upstairs and say, hey, you got to go to work tonight, because I didn't know if somebody was covering him. It turned out that he had somebody else covering his shift that was coming in, but they were late. And so she's like, oh no. And she was serious. She was like, no, I can't go up there. I can go upstairs. So I don't know. He must have them all in check. I'm like, oh, you really an OG. And so. And so he's like, he, sorry, I got off track. He's like, yeah, I have three girlfriends and two more friends, and I'm going there. We do all kind of stuff. So he starts talking about popsicles and KY jelly. And this man, again, he's 68 years old. He's all of 5'1". He wears country boots, big boots. He's a nice guy. He's the only the one one of the only staff that I can really stomach, and but he's an old man, so I wouldn't think. But he keeps his hair did and everything, and he smells like Brute Fabergé. Now y'all remember Brute Fabergé, because that used to be the joint back in the day when I was two. And the old men from that day, they still wear the thing. That stuff is hot, but it stinks. Let me tell you, it don't smell good. And because every time he comes into work, I guess he's getting off, no pun intended, he's leaving one of his ladies, because he comes in and as soon as he walks in the door, the whole place is fumigated with the Brute Fabergé smell. And I want to tell him really, really bad that. Jeremy says he hears me on Facebook. He didn't upload the Spreaker app, so he can't chat. What a nerd. But he's my boy. And so I'm like, yeah, I need to buy him some new cologne. So he's talking about popsicles and KY jelly and what he does to these girls. And he said, and in my mind, I'm like, I don't want to hear that. Just like you don't want to hear about any kind of gay sexual escapade, I don't want to hear about your straight escapade. I want to say this. Let me preface it with, you're 68 years old, and you're talking about having three ways. And he was like, "Don't you?" He was letting me know that he was that dude. I'm like, "Oh, all right." I'm like, "Well, you know what? I'm gonna go on and go." And I kind of moonwalked out the front door because I didn't want to hear anything else. So I thought that was funny. Anyhow, I just had to share that with you guys because I thought it was hilarious. Another quick break, and we'll be back.
Sweetest sound, the
And that was my girl Nick West with Written All Over Me. I so enjoy. I don't know why she hasn't been signed. She does have an album. It's called Just in the Nick of Time, or Nick of Time, or something like that. But I thought it was interesting. Anyhow, so if you've just joined us, I'm David from the 5x5, and this is our 5x5 late night show. We do it on the weekends when I can't sleep and I'm just winding down from work. This is my therapy, what's that stuff that makes you sleep? My NyQuil. this is my where I come down from work. So we just talk about popsicles and put them in people and stuff like that for my elderly coworker, who obviously a G and I didn't know. I was reading on Facebook the other day, well, just a couple days ago. Oh, 1 second. Grandpa Al says he finally got something going every weekend at 10 p.m. Central Time. 3-hour shows about rants and raves, events, and inspirations. Also a few odd. Oh, good. Well, see, Grandpa, that works. I'll only be able to catch an hour of it because I don't get off to 12 o'clock on weekends, but I will definitely be listening. I tried to listen the other day, Grandpa, and I couldn't hear anything. I don't know. You said you were live, and I couldn't hear anything. I don't know why that was. My friend Jeremy, who's on Facebook, he's done the popsicle thing, too. Yes, I just called you out. That's nasty. You're nasty, and I didn't want to hear that. But Jeremy tolerates me. He's one of my really good straight friends, by the way. You got he's been on the show before. Well, he's sat in the chat room before, but since he can't get onto the Spreaker, I'm talking to him on Facebook as well as I'm doing my show. He hears a lot of stuff from me. I throw a lot of stuff out there at Jeremy, and he takes it like a champ. That's a true friend. I've only come in. There's been three straight males in my life that have been really good friends to me. Jeremy being one of them, then my boy Danny in Atlanta, and then an old friend of mine, Roy, that no matter who I was, what I was, being gay included, they accepted it, you know, that part of me. It was no big deal. It's funny, when Jeremy and I reconnected, he probably doesn't know this. There was another classmate of ours there. We all went out and had drinks. Well, we connected, but we had drinks the next night. Anyhow, and I didn't think he knew. And so our classmate, she was like talking about somebody else being gay in our class. And I told her to bring that stuff down, you know, and she's like, what? He doesn't care. So what? You know, so I didn't think he knew it or not, but not that I was embarrassed, but you just don't know how you never know how people will act. But I guess I'm at the age that I really shouldn't care. But anyhow, oh, and I have to give a shout out to the new champions. Yeah, it was Lori. McCracken Cheer Squad. They are the new champions of what? So I can give them their due. They want to cheer. They're the number one cheerleaders in the country. And Jeremy, he participates in that. I think he helps coach the team. And they won today in Miami or Orlando, Florida. I think that's where it was. Grandpa says, I am straight. I go right for the boobs. Motorboating across them makes my teeth rattle. If you guys have not checked out Grandpa Al Kriska show, he is hilarious. One of the funniest people on Spreaker. He'll be in the chat room and he'll just come up with something totally off the wall. Most time it's about his wife, but he'll say something and he always makes me laugh because he's really, 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 really funny. Medium division co-ed national champ. So kudos to the McCracken cheer squad. Oh, and Jeremy says he's with Grandpa with at home. What's wrong with you straight boys? Y'all just need to calm down. We have to start giving, sneaking some estrogen in y'all. Y'all see what's going to happen. Y'all going to be on that show called Sex Sent Me to the ER with your ding-a-ling stuck in a stove. Y'all need to stop it. That's, man, that's what I'm saying. Men, and that's what goes with gay men. I think that's what how society looks at gay men in particular, because they know how straight men act, you know, because straight men are running after every tail and booty and breast, you know, all the time at any age, obviously. And so when they look at a gay man, they're like, so there's two men running after tail, and so since they're having that urge, because it's two men, that urge is there, so they're really doing too much. So maybe that's why they don't like gay people that much. Most a part of society, I'm not gonna say all society, because we're kind of cliche right now. But yeah, y'all need to stop, you know. So I can understand why when some people talk about gay men, it's mostly about the sex part, you know, because they know, because straight men have messed it up, because they always trying to stick the ding-a-ling in something, you know. They will stick the thing in a donut hole if they could, if they thought they could get off from it. Yeah, I said it. Anyhow, I was reading on Facebook the other day. Somebody had posted about the 10 albums that have stuck with you. The 10 albums that has stuck with you, I guess, ever since you was really into music, the albums that you still think of. And I have a few. I don't know if I have 10 that has absolutely stuck with me. And I thought I had it written down, but I don't think I do right. I don't know what I did with it. Have my little notebook. The first album that sticks with me is in my top 10 albums of all time would be Control by Janet Jackson. That's the first one. That's the Control. I remember singing when I was 17. I did what people told me, and I made a mistake, and I said it to my mom one day, and she almost punched me in the mouth. She's like, yeah, you still ain't grown. You need to tell Janet to come adopt you. Go live with her. You have no control in this house. But that's one of my albums that sticks with me. There's a lot of Janet albums. The Velvet Rope. That was for me. That was my coming out album. You know, with songs like Together Again, Free Zone. That was my coming out album. That album came out in the late 90s, 97, maybe 98. Had to be 97, 98. And Get Lonely was on there, Go Deep. And that's when I was partying. I was hitting the clubs really hard. And I was being gay. You know, for the first time in my life, I was being me. And that's another album that sticks with me. Jeremy said he obviously would stick his ding-a-ling in a donut because he likes donuts. Y'all was so nasty. I didn't want to hear that. And so the third album, not a Janet album, it's a more recent album. It's called Lost and Found by Ledisi. If you haven't listened to Ledisi, I don't know what's wrong with you. Ledisi is the truth. Her album, she hasn't had an album since Lost and Found that has been, for me, as moving, as touching. It kind of, you know, the albums that kind of speaks to you, and you can pick a song that's like, yeah, that's what I'm going through right now. You know, that album is one of those albums that has stuck with me since I've heard it. And then I would have to give Fan Mail by TLC. That's another album that has stuck with me. No Scrubs, Silly Ho. You know, that's another one. And you guys will probably laugh at me for this. Another album that sticks with me was Hardcore by Lil' Kim. And the reason why this album sticks with me, even though it was so dirty and so filthy, there's a song on there called Backstabbers. And that was my song. It's still my song. I will still play that song today. It's like, yep, and I'm talking about some haters, and she's talking about she's wearing a bulletproof dress. That song is hot. You need to check that out. Plus, it had Crush on You. That song was kind of tea back in the day. And then that's The Writings on the Wall by Destiny's Child. Another song album that sticks with me. And while I'll say any of Beyoncé's albums are one of the ones that stick with me, it has to be the very her first solo album, Dangerously in Love. That's one of my albums that I like. And I'm gonna say this too. There's a the soundtrack to and I heard this as a kid. It had all these artists on it. The soundtrack to Car Wash. Remember Car Wash? My mom and dad used to play that, back to back to back to back to back. I absolutely loved it. So that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 8 would have to be The Boss by Diana Ross. And she was the boss. 8 would have to be The Boss. And then the first Jill Scott album, that's one of those albums I can listen to like it's brand new. And then the last album, I'm gonna say this, well, I don't know if it's entirely true. This is an album I listened to when I was in high school, and Jeremy probably doesn't know this, because Jeremy didn't talk to me in high school. He has the nerve to be showing all these pictures on Facebook with all these white people, him and all these white folks in sweaters and things. But there was this one guy that we went to high school with that looks like 75, and he was in those pictures. I swore he was like twice our age, but obviously he wasn't. That's an inside joke. Anyhow, Drama According to Bernadette Cooper. Do y'all remember that? Y'all probably don't remember that because you guys are not as cool as I am. Drama According to Bernadette Cooper was the chick who actually started the group Climax. Now, Climax, they tried to have a comeback of sorts. And it I don't know if it didn't work. They had those, those Where Are They Now specials on VH1. They tried to do that with them, and they still couldn't get along. It's like a seven all girl band, and Bernadette Cooper was the one that coined the phrase "slap me" from meetings in the later meeting. A meeting in the ladies' room. Remember that Climax? Well, she had an album called Drama According to Bernadette. And when I tell you, I was living, I think I no, that I wasn't in high school. I was in college. That song came out when I was in college. They had a song called Stupid. Because I was so interested in this one person, and still I can remember this person's name. It was so crazy because I was hung up on this person, and they were straight, but I was so infatuated with this person. I wonder what happened to him, but yeah, that because it has a song on there called "Stupid." So you had to Google that song, "Stupid" by Bernadette Cooper. It's a good song, but we're gonna finish up here after this quick song, and we're gonna talk about what George Zimmerman's been doing here lately. We'll be right back.
Shit, I stun on you.
shit, I stun on you. Stun on you, stun on you. Stun on you, I ain't that bitch.
I ain't that bitch. I switch it up. Grandpa Al says one album that stuck with him was Barry Manilow. He sat on it while it was in the sun and it stuck to his shorts. See, I told you, Grandpa Al's hilarious, y'all. You need to check him out. Welcome back. It's the 5x5 and I'm your host, David, and this is the 5x5 Late Night Show, where I'm just kind of talking about any and everything. And some gossip. So, if you guys remembered last week, telling Jeremy goodnight, he has to crash. Goodnight, JT, JTN, or whatever that is. If you remember last week, you heard some stuff about George Zimmerman. And y'all know who George Zimmerman is. He's the guy that shot an unarmed teenager, Trayvon Martin, because he thought he was up to no good. There was a fight, and he was acquitted of murder and manslaughter, and kind of it polarized the country on race. You know, all those wounds that were not fully healed. If you look back at one of the old shows, on Real Talk with David and Nikki, you can see where we talked about it one night, but the wounds weren't healed, and I don't think it's a wound that will ever heal. I don't think in my generation it will be healed. But he was acquitted for shooting this guy, Trayvon Martin, this young man named Trayvon Martin, and the country went berserk on both sides, and it just showed how race is still a problem in the United States. And it got down to being profiled, and it's that whole, the little white lady grabs a purse when a black man walks into the room. It's that whole stereotype that black males, young and old alike, live with every day, and people try to pretend like it's not a thing, but it is. And you know, even though it hasn't happened to me in a while now, it was almost an everyday occurrence. Someone was giving, you know, snatching up the purse or walking. That's not true. I was in JCPenney's the other day, and I was in the aisle, and then this white lady, she sees me. And, you know, I'm a man of a particular size, and I'm one of the darker brothers. And she sees me, and she looks at me, and she turns around and goes a different way, so she didn't have to go past me. I had to start laughing because I think this stuff is funny, but you know, I think I would expect my older mother. No, my mom's not really scared of nothing. She would keep on walking, but so it happens. Not that she thought something was going to happen to her in the middle of JCPenney's. I don't know. But again, a race and profiling and racism and race, anything is still a hot button. It's an American hot button still in 2014. And oh, by the way, happy Black History Month. We've done some Black History things. We're going to do something else on Tuesday, and I'll tell you guys about that probably tomorrow or the next day if I do a late night show. But anyhow, so, you know, we still have a problem with race. And so George Zimmerman, you know, he was the center of all the media storm that came after the acquittal, of course. And then he went through some other legal troubles with his wife, pulling a gun on her father, and then with his girlfriend, breaking her iPad and allegedly saying he was going to kill her. And so he still has some problems. This individual is obviously very disturbed. And I don't even think, I'm not going to say he's racist because I don't know him. He does racist things. I think he opens his mouth. He says racist thing, even though he's half Peruvian, half white. And people's like, well, he's not even white. Yes, he is. He looks Latino, but he's biracial as well. But he wants to. I don't think he's a disturbed individual, but. He, I guess, a promoter, and had to find Damon Feldman, who does this celebrity fighting. And I don't know why we want to give him a title of celebrity. It's not like he was on, you know, they give those reality stars celebrity, a celebrity label. You know, you'll see them on Dancing with the Stars, which should be Dancing with the Celebrities. He's given this love. He's a celebrity. I guess that he was in the public eye for, you know, a heinous crime that he got away with. So Damon Feldman, he organizes these celebrity bouts, and I guess he approached George Zimmerman. And George Zimmerman's thinking in his mind, he was like, well, to get the heat off me and Black America off my back, I need to fight a Black guy and let him beat the crap out of me. And so maybe this will ease my suffering. I didn't want to hear that. You know, Black America doesn't want to hear that. And I'm like, seriously, dude, you want, this was a few days ago, maybe even a week. He said, I want to fight. And then they'll see that, you know, I can let a Black person beat me up. For one, that's offensive, you know, because it's almost you're making, I killed one of y'all, I'm going to let one of y'all beat me up. That's not what we were looking for, George. We was looking to make sense of it, you know. And, you know, not all white people are bad. Not all Black people are bad. There's some bad Black people and there's some bad white people and other ethnicities as well. But here's the thing. We were trying to make sense of a situation that happens in America. You know, it's not something that we're making up. It's not something that Black men are making up. You know, and you know that saying, which is a poor saying, one rotten apple spoils the whole bunch. Unfortunately, that's how we view things in American society. We let that one apple kind of dictate the behavior of the rest of the bunch. You know, and I just think it was insulting for him to even come up with this. Well, I guess he didn't come up with his own, but his whole, I guess his ideology about the situation is skewed. But like I said, I think he's disturbed. But and so there's going to be a fight. So who pops up talking about I will fight him? DMX, you know, I'm gonna make you lose my mind. You gonna up in here? Remember the song Up in Here? He obviously lost his mind because he is the one saying that he would fight George Zimmerman. And he would F him up and he would beat him down. But here's the thing. George, this is how I thought about it. I'm like, well, George Zimmerman was a Golden Glove boxer or something like that at one point. He might whoop your ass. You know, honestly, DMX, you know. Just because you're black don't mean you can fight and you can scream and stuff. That doesn't make you a fighter. I've seen plenty of bullies and big people who had a big mouth, you know, with the whole showboating thing. If you can yell enough, scream enough, and you know, be intimidating, is less likely than somebody's going to fight you. But when somebody pulls your card, you better be ready. You know, and I've seen many a giant go down. With all that mouth. But so after that, DMX supposedly canceled. Here's what this is on radaronline.com. The touted boxing match between George Zimmerman and DMX has been canceled before either had even gotten in the ring. This is what Damon Feldman says. I want nothing to do with it. It's my decision to cancel the fight. After I saw my son and daughter today, I really thought about what happened. I had a change of heart. And that was from Damon Feldman. He says, I could have made $2 million here, but there's too much controversy and death threats and more. So obviously, people have lost their mind. They're saying, if you do this, we're going to kill you. Which that doesn't make it right either. It was going to occur on the night. This is the real insulting part, on the 19th birthday of Trayvon Martin. And DMX made it clear Friday that he had been challenged but had not committed to the fight. He said it appears that more than one or more of the parties have come to their senses. This was a bad idea in its inception. I mean, seriously. Another way, this is the immoral minority dot blogspot.com, the immoral minority dot blogspot.com. What they say, folks, this is getting ridiculous. Ever since it was announced last Thursday that George Zimmerman, the killer of Trayvon Martin, would participate in a celebrity boxing match on March 1st, every hardened would-be hero is coming out of the woodwork to one-up each other in a misguided contest to avenge the death of an unarmed 17-year-old. Oh, see, I didn't know this. First, it was a rapper, The Game. I've heard of his name, but I don't know him. He's like, I will beat the F out of him. I would not be boxing for me. I'd be boxing for the legacy of Trayvon Martin and for his family. I don't want to hear that from you because that's not. This doesn't make it right. And even you saying you beating him up, they're all, for one, it was only going to go so far. You weren't going to be able to slay him in the ring. You know, you might get a good punch and knock him out, but then still he might get a good punch and knock you out. So if he wins, then what happens? Where is the avenging, your avenging angel stick going to go then? Shut up. We don't want to hear that. And, he said, then he said, I would box him to knock him out. I would definitely take pleasure in it. It's legal, and I want to show him you can solve your disputes without a weapon. But you can solve your disputes with more violence? Like, that makes sense. People really need to think before they open their damn mouths. I don't want to hear that. And then, of course, I talked about the rapper. DMX says, I'm going to beat the living F out of him. I am breaking every rule in boxing to make sure I F him up right. And obviously he says some other horrible things. He says he was fighting for every black person who has ever been done wrong in the system. I mean, seriously. I mean, stop giving this platform to show his face. We just want you to go away. You know, if we see you in 5 years from now, it's still too soon. And you know, whoever this Damon Feldman, whoever he is, just stirring the pot didn't make any things any better. I think it was sick and it was uncalled for, and he ought to be ashamed of himself. So With that being said, I'm not going to speak any more about George Zimmerman and this boxing mess that he has, well, which has been canceled, thankfully. Grandpa Al Krishka in the chat room says, my mom and dad always told me one thing, a person's skin color is not important to liking someone. True. The way everyone holds their head up high and is proud of who they are and show it by giving a smile when all they see is anger. That is a true human. None other would be so if all they saw was the color of their skin. Very true and wise words from Grandpa Al Krishka. Oh, and about the record, he said it was true. It happened at a outdoor party, and his niece put it in the sun, so that's why it stuck to him. Let's see. Do we play another song? Of course we play another song. That's what we do on the 5x5 Late Night Show. We play another song, and I get to talk some more. But we're going to play one more song, and then we'll come back and we'll wrap up.
Tryna get that honey, that's all we do. Challenge no be easy. Sometimes you gotta go somewhere to cool your head. Breathe in the air, sun so clear. No worries to bother you there. Sit even on a beach, baby, on an island, yeah. Go to a lake house, baby, break out and make out. Feeling free like the wind I'm supposed to be.
I don't know.
Getaway by EFYA. I don't know how to pronounce that, so I'm not going to try. The Getaway. Welcome back. We're wrapping up, winding down. It's getting time for me to go to bed. But one last thing I wanted to talk about, tell you guys about. Online, I'm not above online dating. I'm on some of the little apps. You all know them. Grindr, Growler, Scruff. You know, those type of apps. And thing is, not that you're going to find anybody of significance on there. It just doesn't happen, I don't think. You know, I think people can surprise you. But more than likely, they don't. And so recently, what I don't get, what happened to me, just within the last couple of days, I forget what app it was on. Anyhow, this person hits me up, and very, very attractive, built. I'm like, oh, I'll play with you, you know, and play in the sense online, because you don't even live in the country, supposedly. And so, you know, he's talking and saying stuff. Oh, you're handsome. Oh, you have a nice smile and all this kind of craziness. And I'm like, oh, thank you. What's up? You know, how are you? Blah, blah. I don't mind chatting with people. Chatting's totally fine, you know, whatever. And so I wish I had my stuff together so I could read some of this nonsense. Because sometimes you got to shut it down. And I was reading a tweet. Prime at Prime Boxing favorited my show on Twitter. Thank you at Prime Boxing. I hope you, if you're listening to the show, I hope you're enjoying it. I appreciate that. Let's see. I'm trying to find the. That's not it. See, at least I don't know why grown people continue, and I guess it's just the way it is, continue to play games online. And because, you know, I'm not one for games. Let me read how this started, and I want to be quick here. And so I had to load earlier. I love my new phone, by the way. I told you guys I got a new phone. I'm enjoying it. He says, hello though, how are you? I said, I'm good. He says, nice meeting you here. And I'm like, he's like, tell me something about yourself. So it starts off pretty good. And I'm like, well, I'm a comic book nerd. I love all things geeky. I'm a podcaster. So like that. And then he gives the obligatory. We do the age, name, location. And or age, sex, and location. And so then it gets to, I lost my work and I'm suffering here. And so I'm like, here, where is here? Supposedly he lives in Ghana, West Africa. I'm like, really? Seriously, dude? Which, okay, whatever. I don't mind making online friends from around the world. I can be internationally known. I can be international. And so he gives me all this information. He says he was born in Florida, but working in West Africa and Ghana. He said lost both parents because he was gay and family dislikes me to live with them. Having a terrible life in Florida. He's a Cuban and he speaks Spanish, learning more English. Have been here for 8 months now. Lost my work as I was working for a company here in this part of Ghana. I'm like, wow, I'm sorry to hear that. He says, don't worry, life goes on. And I'm like, that's true. So I'm like, okay, he's a positive young person. He's enjoying it. And he puts, no one knows tomorrow. I was like, exactly, that's a good constitution to have. That's what I say. And then he says, tell me more about yourself. So I went and told him some basic stuff. Because you can't give some of these people online too much information, because they'll be trying to find out where you live and get into your bank account and steal your money and stuff. And so he's like, he's telling me about his family again. They hate him because he's gay, which is unfortunate. I tried to, you know, tell him that, you know, my family's not like that and I'm sorry. And, you know, sometimes they come around in time. And then he's like, he lost his work about 2 months ago. And He has no work and found it hard to eat and pay bills. I said, so when are you coming back to the United States? And he says, well, life is too short to be stressed. I'm like, that's true. He said, I'm looking for work, then save up for return. And I said, well, why did you lose your job? He said, the company closed down for misunderstanding between them and the management here. Here's the thing with me, these are all red flags. With me, if you say that the you would think they would send you back. They don't. If you're working over there, you're not. You don't. You're not a. Yeah. This is that's why it's all lies. You're not a resident of Ghana. You have a passport. You're on some type of work visa. You're there working for the company. When the company is no longer working, then you have to go back to your country. And so I keep on throwing these questions at him. He's not answering. He's like, well, it's really tough for me. No food to eat. I'm like, well, you don't have any friends there. He's like, things are hard for me, and I also don't have anyone to talk to or share my ideas with. No friends. The one who helped me get a job here sadly died. Well, it says sadness. Sadly died with cancer, and there's no gay life here. I said, well, it seems like you're a smart guy. I know you'll make it. You need to go to the U.S. Embassy and see if they can help you get back home. He says, I'm still praying. I have tried and nothing comes of it. That's a lie. And I'm like, well, I'm sorry. And then he sends me a few pics. And like I said, when I tell you this person is really, 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 which is probably not him. The pictures that he sent me of somebody, the person's really attractive. And he says, you're such a nice man and you seem very calm and you're really handsome. Yeah, thanks. I know I am. And he says, do I have a computer and internet as well as a webcam at home? I have it on my phone, I have it on my iPod Touch, and I have it on my computer. Yes, I do. He says, I have both of my internet have been disconnected as I haven't paid for it yet. So how are you using your phone? This is on that WhatsApp app. And he's like, I would, here, here's where it gets deep. He says, I will be happy to build a solid relationship with you and meet. Boy, I'm not going back to the motherland. They don't want me in Africa. They do not want me in Africa. They don't want me coming over there. Yeah, Grandpa asked, yep, so much for the nice scam artist. Yeah, I'm not going back to Ghana to come get you. It's not like I'm driving down the street. And he says, I said, oh, really now? He says, I will also be happy to talk and see each other at the same time, but it's hard for me to make this happen since I haven't paid my internet bill. So this is where this is the kind of the what's the call the subliminal suggestion, the suggestion to say, oh, if I want it because I'm so desperate and lonely, then I'll send you money so you can pay your internet bill that we can see each other. Yeah, that's not going to happen. He obviously didn't know he was talking to. So I'm playing with him. I'm like, well, we can't. Don't you have Skype on your phone? He says, my phone doesn't support Skype. I have it on my computer, and then sends me a smiley face crying. I said, oh, okay, sorry, no big deal. And he's like, no big deal. I'm like, it means it'll be okay. And then he asked what time it was here and whatever. And then this gets a little bit more serious. He says, dear, my dear, can you help me a little? I'm going to read it just how he wrote it. My dear, can you help me little funds to buy foodstuffs here as am out of food, okay? He needs to call Sally Struthers so she can get him some food. I know she's over there in Africa somewhere. I said, well, although I would like to help, I'm not accustomed to sending money to someone I just met online. I'm sorry. He said, I understand. I am sorry. I said, I'm sorry. I really feel bad for you, your situation. And then he sends me a picture of his passport. Now, mind you, your passport, well, whatever, whoever's person they're using, it is the same person, but it didn't like any kind of passport I've ever seen. But it looks official enough. And so the passport was expired in 2013. If you were being completely honest, they would have kicked you behind out of the country. You know, now you have to go to the U.S. Embassy or somewhere to get your passport reinstated so you can come back to the States. I'm sure you don't speak Swahili. Whatever. He says, don't worry, sorry to ask. Just that I'm feel hungry here and living without foodstuffs, okay? And I said, why is your passport expired? No answer. And so the next day, he says, how are you? I'm working. What's up? And he did I put a question mark for some reason. He said, what have you been doing? Working. Then he says, babe, I mean, babe, it's tough for me as I had nothing for foodstuffs, crying. Like I said, I feel sorry for you. I said, do you have no other one that can help you? No one, babe. That is why I'm calling upon your aid to just help me with little funds for foodstuffs, please. And a whole bunch of crying smileys. I said, so if this were to happen, how would it happen? This was, it gets really interesting. He's like, do you know Western Union money transfer? Boy, please. If you have any kind of internet device, you can use PayPal, but obviously you don't want a some kind of track. I don't know. And I'm like, okay. I said, yeah, I'm not doing that. He puts about, why, babe? I think that's overseas money transfer. I said, yeah, I'm not sure you are who you are. He said, well, I'm honest with you, okay? And then sends me a picture and a voice message, which I'm gonna see if you guys can hear this. Hold on. It says, what's up, babe? Where's the microphone? I don't know if you guys can hear this. Oh, wait a minute. One more time. Now, that was your voice message. It was 2 seconds. Yeah. And then I said, so where do you live exactly? Because the name that I got off of the passport that he sent me is, well, it was from somebody who lives in Florida. I'm like, dude, come on now. You're sitting down in Florida, at some internet cafe trying to play, are you a Nigerian? He's like, Ghana, West Africa. I said, this all seems weird. He said, what is weird? I said, why is your passport expired? No answer. And then so he sends me a whole bunch of other messages I'm not answering. And then the next message I get, which was today, babe, still suffering. I don't know what to do. How are you? So I pretty much shut it down and not being mean. I'm like, oh, I had car problems this morning. He says, so what are you doing now? I'm at work, my car's in the shop. A lot of money I got to spend on my car. We've had a lot of snow and ice. I guess my car couldn't take it anymore. He says, sorry. I'm like, yeah, it sucks. I said, I hate winter. It's dry. He said, it's dry and hot here. I said, wish it was like that here. I said, it's been crazy. So did you get anything to eat today? And that was at 4 o'clock this afternoon, and I haven't received any more messages. Hopefully that is done. People are crazy. Don't, boy. I have pissed in way too many puddles to be scammed by somebody online. Remember when they used to send that scam to you? The Nigerian prince wants to get your bank account so they can put $27 million in it. Yeah. And Monopoly money. Grandpa Al says, I usually tell them I am unhappily married, and if anything, I will send them my wife. They run like hell. Well, I think that's all I have for tonight. Thank you guys for listening to me ramble, ramble, ramble. Don't forget to check out the blog. Check out the Trevor Wayne interview. It was really, really good. Go to his site at trevorwayne.com. And if you go back a few episodes, check out Alan Chen. I just ordered his one of his books online called Match Point. So I'm gonna be reading that so I don't watch so much television. And it's supposed to warm up here. We're finally getting out of the whole ice and igloo. I had to actually use my ice scraper the other day on the car, not as a scraper, but as a hammer to break the ice off in pieces because I couldn't get inside my car because it was so cold and ice and all that kind of stuff. Thank you guys for listening. I appreciate each and every one of you. Send a quick shout out to my boy Dwayne Hadley, who's always very complimentary and always gives me a shout out on his show. Check him out. We're going to be doing another WWE show here soon before Survivor Series or some kind of wrestling thing, which I have some stuff about John Cena, but I can talk about that at any time. Thank you guys. Primetime Boxing on Twitter, thank you for checking us out. Grandpa Al, it's always a pleasure. Jeremy, thank you for checking us out. I'm here, you're here, we're here. It's the 5x5 late night, and we'll see you next time. Bye bye.